So great. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming here, for being here. I know it is, the time is very important for you in taking out time from your hectic schedule. To be here, to see, to be here in this event is really, something that really means a lot to us. So thank you so much. A very, very warm welcome to all of you. As you all know, this event is in the memory of Father Stan Swamy, who dedicated his life serving the poor and empowering the oppressed. He relentlessly fought for their rights guaranteed by the Constitution. To introduce myself, I'm Rivya Singh. I'm a lawyer. I run a law firm called Oris Law Partners. It's an honor to be an MC in this event and to hear some of the most eminent personalities talking about Father Stan, who I revere. And the significance of freedom of speech, freedom of expression, and our human rights universal. It gives me an immense pleasure to welcome Father Plavendran Iriduswamy to the stage. As you all know, Father Plavendran is the principal of St. Paul's College, where the event is organized. He has a doctorate from a Roman university and is actively engaged in conducting seminars and conferences on media-related themes. Thank you so much, Father, for organizing this. Please join me. Please join me with a round of applause in welcoming Father Mascarenhas, former principal of Xavier's College, to the stage. Father was also the one who took care, as we all know, we've heard about it, Father was also the one who took care of Father Stan until his last breath and was appointed as next of his kin. On behalf of everyone here, we thank you, Father, for taking care of Father Stan and your continued and unwavering fight to help seeking justice. Now for the most awaited guest of the evening, and I must say that. It's an absolute delight to welcome you, Dr. Tharoor. Dr. Tharoor needs no introduction. His name in itself is an introduction for him. Dr. Tharoor is a multifaceted personality. He started his career as a civil servant, a diplomat. He is currently a member of parliament from Thiruvananthapuram. He's a renowned writer and has written several books, one of which we are about to be launching today. And my favorite is Inglorious Empire. In addition, Dr. Tharoor, and this is something that I must say, Dr. Tharoor has done a few stand-ups as well, and I am particularly a fan of that. And I must say he is brilliant at that as well. So let's welcome Dr. Tharoor. I hope you all have your dictionaries ready. And last but not the least, please join me in welcoming Advocate Matthew Anthony to the stage. Matthew is a friend, he's a lawyer, and he's a founder of Indasta Foundation that focuses on education, skill building, and poverty alleviation of underprivileged. Great. One round of applause for all the speakers, please. So I request Father Plavendran to please start with the welcome note. Thank you.
Respected Dr. Shashi Tharoor ji, Mr. Matthew Anthony, the chief organizer of this event, Father Reynold Pascal, the vice principal of this college, members of faculty and students of St. Paul's College, directors of various departments of St. Paul's campus, distinguished guests from various religious communities, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the management, staff and students of St. Paul's College, Mumbai, I extend a cordial and warm welcome to all of you who have come in large number to the first Father Stan Swamy Memorial Lecture on Our Human Rights Universal, organized at St. Paul's College. It's a college which conducts various media-related courses at postgraduate and undergraduate level. The latest course being added to the curriculum of the college is the 6-month filmmaking course. Today's memorial lecture is arranged in line with the tagline of St. Paul's College, Mumbai, which reads as, in quest for truth and excellence. In exploring the truth, Father Stanislaus Lourdeswamy wanted to give dignity to all human persons, especially to the tribals and Adivasis. Particularly, Father Stan dedicated his entire life on fighting for Jal, Jungle and Zameen for the tribal population of India. In other words, he lived to give dignity for the least, the last and the lost people of India. This memorial lecture on Are Human Rights Universal gains significance on three grounds. One, this memorial lecture is conducted on a right time. We have gathered here to ponder over human rights issues while we celebrate 75 years of India's independence, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. Two, this memorial lecture is conducted at a right place. We have gathered in an institution where media-related activities have been conducted for the last several decades, fearlessly safeguarding the human rights of young minds, St. Paul's College, Mumbai. Three, this lecture is delivered by a right person. We couldn't ask for a better person than Dr. Shashi Tharoor ji to explore the nuances of human rights as he experienced in the life of Father Stan Swamy. I am confident that Dr. Shashi Tharoor will throw greater insights into the lives of Father Stan, pondering his life from the prism of human rights activities. Once again, I welcome you all to the memorial lecture and I wish you all a great evening ahead. Thank you.
Request Father Mascarenhas to set the stage, please. Father Mascarenhas to set the stage. Thank you. Yes.
Well, I've already spoken about 20 minutes now on Father Stan Swamy. But since Mr. Tharoor has not heard that, I'm going to have to repeat it all. Okay, just let me end with this one thing, you know, which I didn't really speak of. But something that gripped Father Stan really strongly was the lovely culture of the Adivasis. He was really in love with the culture, and he thought that was important for India to imbibe, to appreciate, and even to learn from the culture of the Adivasis. That was what his commitment was all about. Mr. Tharoor, it's all yours.
Thank you, Father Pravindran, Father Fraser Mascarenhas, my good friend Matthew Anthony, and the very patient audience whom I will not keep waiting any longer. It really is a pleasure to join you all this evening and a privilege to be delivering the inaugural Father Stan Swamy Memorial Lecture. And of course, in so doing, I'd like to start by paying tribute to this extraordinary champion of human rights. Stan Swamy's death last year witnessed a major outpouring of sorrow and regret across India, as individuals of every conceivable religious and political affiliation, and none, barring of course those with any connection to the ruling party, expressed their great sorrow at his death in police custody. A Jesuit priest who had devoted himself to the well-being of the tribals in Jharkhand, serving them selflessly, dying in police custody without ever having been convicted of any crime. This was the kind of injustice that our constitution and laws were written to prevent. I've just launched my book on Dr. Ambedkar, who chaired the drafting committee of our constitution. And I can only imagine what he would have said at seeing this transcendent injustice. Stan Swamy's passing, of course, won him the attention of people who were unaware of his struggles while he was alive. I must confess, I was one of them until the news of his detention made the media, and then, of course, the news of his ill treatment outraged a lot of us. Until then, I was one of those who were ignorant of the extraordinary contributions he made, which is why I'm sorry I missed Father Mascarenhas's 20-minute version, because I would have learned a lot more. But nonetheless, I do join, along with all the others who became aware of what happened, in the widespread condemnation of the system that could have done this to him. He was a good man whose spiritual beliefs prompted him to work for the most dispossessed of our society, and our system was responsible for his death. And seeking to discredit his life, as some have done, by reference to Marxism or liberation theology, is an unworthy endeavor on the part of some of his critics. Let us instead simply mourn the passing of a good soul and take stock of the grim reality that Father Stan Swamy spent his life trying to defend against the dehumanization of the original inhabitants of this ancient land. Across the country, whether it is with what happened to Stan Swamy, whether it's in Kashmir where citizens were placed under a clampdown for over a year, whether it is the incredible hardship faced by people across the country, but particularly our migrant workers as a result of the overnight lockdown to curb the COVID pandemic, or in many other parts of the country where unspeakable horrors have been perpetrated by individual citizens and the state alike, usually targeting members of a specific minority. Or even in Delhi, where I have just come, where the government has used its majority in parliament to regularly pass legislation with grim implications for human rights. And in all the places where bulldozer justice has somehow supplanted the provisions of our laws and our constitution. In all these areas, the fundamental assault on human rights continues every single day in our country, especially when the state willfully abdicates its constitutional responsibility to uphold our rights. Sadly, of course, and that's why the theme of my speech is broader than this, these are not trends that are limited to India alone. As the very foundations of democracy weaken across the world, we have seen the rise of populist, far-right, and authoritarian regimes taking over. In turn, these regimes have aided, either directly or by not actively clamping down on violators, the resurgence of xenophobic politics, anti-immigrant sentiments, an accentuation in many countries ruled by people of European origin of systematic and entrenched racism, of mounting inequality, of an erosion of the autonomy of institutions that can offer a check and balance on their governments, and of course, a clampdown on dissent. All of this has resulted in a fundamental challenge to human rights across the world. This is precisely why it is all the more important for us to engage with the concept of human rights in a serious way, to understand how these were developed and how these have been implemented within society, and where we as concerned citizens can further develop our rights and make sure that they're upheld with rigor. I'm therefore particularly pleased that you've given me the honor of inaugurating this lecture series today, because my understanding is there will be an annual Stan Swamy Memorial Lecture, and this is only the first in the series. And I'm hoping that the series will not just engender a greater appreciation for the values that the rights Stan Swamy fought for offer to all of us, but could perhaps also bring up new champions for new voices and new champions for human rights in our society. Now, the question that is the theme of my talk, are human rights universal, is a question that actually has been debated around the world. But I wanted to raise it in front of all of you today in this institution of learning. The claim that human rights are universal has, of course, provoked many interesting questions. Is anything, one might say, in our pluricultural, multipolar world truly universal? Does the very concept of universality not presuppose a rather unitary or monolithic view of the world? Specifically, as some have suggested, including in our country, isn't human rights an essentially Western concept, ignoring the very different cultural, economic, and political realities of the other parts of the world. Can the values of the consumer society be applied to societies which have nothing to consume? Isn't talking about universal rights rather like saying that the rich and the poor both have the same right to fly first class and to sleep under bridges? Don't human rights, as laid out in the International Human Rights Covenants, ignore the traditions, the religions, and the socio-cultural practices of what used to be called the Third World? And at the risk of sounding frivolous, when you stop a man in traditional dress beating his wife, are you upholding her human rights or violating his? I raise these questions to make the point that a number of serious objections to the assumption of universality of human rights have been raised around the world. And I thought it might be worthwhile to briefly dwell on these, because I think we sometimes, particularly in the more advanced democracies, tend to take these things much too much for granted without really paying heed to the other side of the argument. There are, I think, six overlapping categories of objections, of course, and one can divide them in other ways. But very simply, the first objection to the universality of human rights is what I might call the philosophical objection, which asserts essentially that nothing can be universal, that all rights and values are defined and limited by cultural perceptions. There is no universal culture, therefore there are no universal human rights. In fact, some philosophers have actually objected to the concept of human rights by saying it's founded on an anthropocentric, that is a human-centered view of the world. And they say that human rights are predicated upon an individualistic view of man, of human beings, as man as an autonomous being whose greatest need is to be free from interference by the state, free to enjoy what one Western writer summed up as the right to private property, the right to freedom of contract, and the right to be left alone. That's perhaps an absolutist view, but it is a popular view in the West. Now, such a view, these philosophers say, clashes with the communitarian idea propounded by other philosophies, other ideologies, and cultures, which says that society is much more than the sum of its individual members. It has rights of its own that transcend those of individuals. So that's broadly the first category of objections. This flows into the second category, which one might call the cultural objections. In a number of non-Western cultures, individuals are not accorded rights in the same way as they are in the West or even in our democracy. It is suggested, for example, now if you're going culturally, we have to go behind before our constitution. So in the Confucian or the Vedic tradition, it is argued that duties are considered more important than rights. In Africa, there is a strong belief that it is the community that protects and nurtures the individual. Even conflict resolution would not necessarily be based, it is suggested, on the assertion and defense of individual rights. So in our country, right, you feel your rights are violated, you go to court, you say, I as an individual citizen, I have these rights, they've been violated. But in some cultures, that's not the way it's supposed to happen. In fact, one African writer summed up the African philosophy of existence as, I am because we are, and because we are, therefore I am. So African writers have argued that they have a complex structure of communal entitlements and obligations grouped around what one might call four R's, and these are not rights, but respect, restraint, responsibility, and reciprocity. In most African societies, therefore, group rights, they argue, had precedence over individual rights, and political decisions were made through group consensus, not through individual assertions. So that's a very different view of human rights. A third category of objections to the universality of human rights is what one could call the North-South argument. That is a suggestion that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948, adopted at the UN, whose 75th anniversary is just around the corner next year, that this declaration was adopted at a time when most third world countries were still under colonial rule. And so they say the Universal Declaration itself reflects an ethnocentric bias. And so this objection suggests that the concept of human rights is really a cover for Western intervention in the affairs of the developing world, that human rights are merely an instrument of Western political neocolonialism. One critic, and I think it was an Indian, wrote of his fear that human rights might turn out to be a Trojan horse surreptitiously introduced into other civilizations, which will then be obliged to accept those ways of living, thinking, and feeling for which human rights is the proper solution in cases of conflict. Now that leads us to the fourth category of objections, what one might call the ethnocentrism argument, which objects essentially to specific rights in the Universal Declaration, which are deemed reflective of cultural bias. The right, for instance, to political pluralism. The right to paid vacations. That's one of the things in the Universal, United Nations Covenant on Social and Economic Rights. Every human being has a right to a paid vacation. That's always good for a laugh in some of the sweatshops of the developing world. And of course, most troublesome of all, particularly to some societies, as we've been seeing in the news the last few months, most troublesome of all, the rights of women. At its most earnest, this objection points out that some societies are simply unable to provide certain rights to all their citizens. At its most angry, this objection is to the promotion of rights explicitly emerging from Western social values. And that's particularly in relation to the assertion of equality between the sexes. How can women's rights be universal, they say, in the face of widespread divergences of cultural practice, when in some societies, for example, marriage is not seen as a contract between two equal individuals, but as an alliance between lineages, between families, and when the permissible behavior of women folk is central to the society's perception of its honor? And then if we can move on to the fifth category, which is the religious argument. Human rights, some religious people say, can only be acceptable if they're founded on religious values, transcendent values symbolized by God and sanctioned by the guardians of various faiths. Now, the Universal Declaration claims no such heritage. A draft reference to the Creator was actually consciously left out of the final text in 1948. So conflict between the universality of human rights standards and the particularity of religious perspectives is therefore a real concern. Many religions also assert that they are the only true religions. So for them to accept a common denominator of human rights that's universally valid and applicable is to admit of the possibility of compromise on the basic tenet of their own exclusive infallibility. I'm sure this is all getting very depressing, all these objections, right? So I'll come to the final one, and that's the development argument. And this argument, I'm sure anyone in India is familiar with, the argument that the developing countries cannot afford human rights since the tasks of nation building, economic development, and the consolidation of the state structure to these ends are still unfinished. Authoritarianism, some argue, is more efficient in promoting development and economic growth. The argument is sometimes a little more subtle than that, because then they say the suspension or limiting of human rights is therefore portrayed as the sacrifice of the few for the benefit of the many. Right? So you violate the human rights of a troublesome minority in order to protect the human rights of the larger majority. That's the argument. The human rights concept is understood, applied, and argued over, they say, only by a small westernized minority in developing countries. Universality in these circumstances is just the universality of the privileged. Human rights, they say, is for the few who have the concerns of Westerners. It does not extend to the lowest rungs of the ladder. So that's what our advocates here might call the case for the prosecution, the indictment. Now, let me respond briefly to each of these points. To take the philosophical objection first, I think it's fair to state that concepts of justice and law, the legitimacy of government, the dignity of the individual, protection from oppression or arbitrary rule, and participation in the affairs of the community are all found in every society on the face of this earth. The challenge of human rights today is to identify the common denominators rather than to throw up one's hands at the impossibility of universalism. In fact, a number of developing countries, notably India, also China, Chile, Cuba, Lebanon, Panama, actually did play an active and highly influential part in the drafting of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. In the case of the human rights governance, which came later, came in the early 60s, the developing world actually made the decisive contribution because it was the so-called new majority of the third world states emerging from colonialism, including Ghana and Nigeria in particular, that broke the logjam between the East and the West. There was a stalemate that had held up the adoption of the covenants for nearly two decades. So the principle of human rights have been widely adopted, imitated, and ratified by developing countries. The fact that therefore they were devised by less than a third of the states now in existence is really irrelevant. After all, the same is true of the United Nations itself, which is also established by just 50-odd member states, 54, I think, back in 1945. But no one questions its universality today, not even the Swiss. So the objections, I think, reflect a false opposition between the primacy of the individual. Thank you. My throat has been taking a bit of a beating over the last couple of weeks for reasons you may have seen in the press. So I need to keep lubricating it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Between the primacy of the individual and the paramountcy of society. Many of the civil and political rights protect groups, while many of the social and economic rights protect individuals. More important, the two sets of rights and the two covenants that codify them are sort of Siamese twins. They are inseparable and interdependent, sustaining and nourishing each other. So there's a UN covenant on political rights, civil and political, and there's another one on social and economic. And trying to keep a separation between civil and political is for the West, social and economic for the developing countries. I don't buy that. I think it all goes together. Now, while conflict between group rights and individual rights is not, in my view, really inevitable, it would be naive to pretend that it doesn't occur, that would never occur. Because very often you have issues coming up where a group wants something and some individual within the group doesn't want it, and then who prevails, right? But while groups may collectively exercise rights, the individuals within them should also be permitted the exercise of their rights within the group, rights which the group may not infringe upon. And I say this because culture is often, too often cited as a defense against human rights by authoritarian regimes who are cheerfully willing to crush culture domestically when it suits them to do so. Also, the traditional culture that is sometimes advanced to justify the non-observance of human rights in practice no longer exists in pure form in any country. Every culture evolves, right? The societies of developing countries have not remained in some pristine pre-Western state. All have been subject to change and distortion by external influence, both as a result of colonialism in many cases and through participation in modern interstate relations. So you can't impose the notion of a modern nation state cutting across, say, tribal boundaries in Africa or conventions. You have your president, you have your ambassador at the UN and so on, and then you want to argue that tribal tradition should be applied to judge the human rights conduct of what is a modern state. You really can't have it both ways. Now, I'd actually go one step further and say that though culture matters, there's nothing sacrosanct about culture anyway. Culture is constantly evolving in any living society, responding to both internal and external stimuli. And there is much in every culture that societies quite naturally outgrow and reject. Am I, as an Indian, obliged to defend in the name of my culture the practice of sati, which was banned over 180 years ago, of obliging widows to immolate themselves on their husband's funeral pyres? Or the fact that slavery was acceptable across the world for at least 2,000 years does not make it acceptable today? The deep historical roots of anti-Semitism in European culture cannot justify discrimination against Jews today, and so on. So all these were once part of traditional cultures. Untouchables weren't allowed into Hindu temples. We just don't do that anymore, and that's because cultures have the capacity to evolve. So my basic problem with the culture argument is that it subsumes all members of a society under a cultural framework that might actually be inimical to them. If you can advocate the cultural argument with an escape clause, that is, if you say, well, we won't coerce the dissenters, we'll allow everyone inside the group, inside the culture, to assert their individual rights to opt out, then I have no problem with it. So those who freely choose to live by and to be treated according to their traditional cultures are welcome to do so, provided others who wish to be free are not oppressed in the name of a culture they prefer to disavow. Now, that sounds very abstract. I'll give you an example. In India, under our law today, say if you're a Muslim woman, you can marry under Muslim personal law, or if you choose, you can marry under civil law and sign a Special Marriage Act license. In those circumstances, if you choose to marry under Muslim personal law, you're affirming the rights of the entire group, that is the community of Muslims, and you're one of them. Whereas, if you marry under civil law, you've basically chosen to opt out of the group in that one thing. You may not opt out of the group when it comes to, say, going to pray on a Friday or five times a day or whatever else you'd like to do, but you may want to opt out on this one thing. That's up to you. As long as that right is there, it seems to me that we can accept the argument of some cultural differences. But let's go on further and take the often contentious issue of the rights of women, because there are still many conservative societies in the world. We've been seeing the news about Iran over the last few weeks, and it's been quite grim. Over 100 women have been killed in protesting for the right not to wear the hijab. Now, I raise this because whenever we have this issue about objections to specific rights, allegedly Western rights, they very frequently involve the issue of the rights of women. And they're usually vociferously argued by men. So let us concede, for argument's sake, that child marriage, widow inheritance, female circumcision, and the like are not found reprehensible by some societies. But let us also ask the victims of these practices how they feel about them. How many teenage girls who've had their genitalia mutilated would have agreed to undergo circumcision if they had the human right to refuse to permit it? For me, the standard is simple. Where coercion exists, rights are violated. And these violations must be condemned, whatever the traditional justification. So it is not culture that is the test, it is coercion. On religion, it's my belief that men allow God to be blamed for their own sins. Right, Father? And that human rights as we understand them are fully compatible with a secular understanding of all faiths. Every religion seeks to embody certain verities that are applicable to all mankind. Justice, truth, mercy, compassion. Though the details of their interpretation vary according to the historical and geographical context in which the religion originated. As my late boss, mentor, and friend, the former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan, would often remind us, the problem is usually not with the faith, but with the faithful. In any case, freedom is not a value found only in Western faiths. It is highly prized in many other faiths. Buddhism, for example, talks about human freedom. No different in Hinduism, no different aspects of Hinduism and Islam. So that's, I think, where I leave it for now. But finally, there is this question of the need to suspend human rights in the interests of paternalistic development. I think it's obvious that authoritarianism promotes repression, not development. Development is about change. And repression prevents change. In fact, as the Nobel laureate Amartya Sen has pointed out in a number of interesting pieces, that there is now a generally agreed upon list of policies that are helpful to economic development. And I'm quoting Amartya Sen, openness to competition, the use of international markets, a high level of literacy and school education, successful land reforms, and public provision of incentives for investment, export, industrialization. Now, none of these requires authoritarianism. That's the main point. None is incompatible with human rights. Indeed, it's the availability of political and civil rights that give people the opportunity to draw attention to their needs and to demand action from the government. In fact, Amartya Sen's work has established, for example, that no substantial famine has ever occurred in any independent and democratic country with a relatively free press. Now, that's striking, because what he's basically arguing is, if a famine seems to be beginning, there's drought and so on, a free press will draw attention to the drought, to people suffering, people starving, and immediately a responsive government will spring into action, attend to it. So it's actually true. We've had no famine since the British left. There was one near famine. There can be debates about whether you can call it a famine or not in Bihar in 66, 67. But every other time when a drought should have led to a famine, it did not, because the media and the government responded immediately. Next week, I'll take one more sip and thank you, and no more. Thank you very much. So, the point is that, yes, you can find authoritarian states, China is a famous example, which have had great success in achieving economic growth. But it's debatable that they needed to be authoritarian to grow like this. You can take an example like Botswana, an exemplar of democracy in Africa, which has grown faster than any authoritarian state. And they've been doing it throughout as a free democracy. In any case, when one hears of the unsuitability or inapplicability or ethnocentrism or cultural bias, etc., of human rights, what are the unstated assumptions that we are not hearing? What exactly are these human rights that it's so unreasonable to promote? If you pick up the Covenant on Civil and Human Rights, Civil and Political Rights, which is what poor Stan Swamy found violated in his own case, and you look through the list, what can one find that someone in a developing country can easily do without? Not the right to life, I hope. Freedom from torture, the right not to be enslaved, not to be physically assaulted, not to be arbitrarily arrested, imprisoned, or executed. No one actually advocates in so many words the abridgment of any of these rights. If I can quote my late boss again, who had a speech at Tehran University many moons ago, famously said, "When have you heard a free voice demand an end to freedom? Where have you heard a slave argue for slavery? When have you heard a victim of torture endorse the ways of the torturer? Where have you heard the tolerant cry out for intolerance?" That was Kofi Annan a few years ago. So tolerance and mercy have always in all cultures been ideals of government rule and human behavior. If we do not unequivocally assert the universality of the rights that oppressive governments abuse, and if we admit that these rights can be diluted and changed, ultimately we risk giving oppressive governments an intellectual justification for the morally indefensible. Objections to the applicability of international human rights standards have all too frequently been voiced by authoritarian rulers and power elites to rationalize their violations of human rights. Violations which serve primarily, if not solely, to sustain them in power. At St. Paul's, I think we can recite the famous line that the devil can quote scripture for his purpose. But similarly, third world communitarianism can be the slogan of a deranged tyrant trained as, say, Pol Pot in Cambodia was at the Sorbonne. The authentic voices of the developing world know how to cry out in pain. Let us heed them. At the same time, let us not forget that the right to development is also a universal human right. The very concept of development evolved in tune with the concept of human rights, decolonization, self-determination, advanced side by side with a consciousness of the need to improve the standards of living of the colonized peoples. The idea that human rights could be ensured merely by the state not interfering with individual freedom cannot survive confrontation with a billion hungry, deprived, illiterate, jobless human beings around the globe. So that's enough, actually. Thank you. No more. Thank you. So many of whom are in the Indian subcontinent. There's a famous phrase that says, human rights start with breakfast. You know, you need to be able to eat to fully enjoy your human rights. So for the sake of the deprived, the notion of human rights has to be a positive action one, active one. Not just protection from the state, but also protection by the state, the protection of the state, to permit human beings to fulfill the basic aspirations of growth and development, which are frustrated by poverty and scarce resources. So that is the tragedy of Stan Swamy all over again, because here was his human rights being violated when what he was attempting to do was to fulfill those basic aspirations of the Adivasi people, suffering from poverty, scarcity, and frankly neglect, except for people like him. And in the process, sadly, he was incarcerated and lost his life. We have to accept that social deprivation and economic exploitation are just as evil as political oppression or racial persecution. This calls for a more profound approach to both human rights and to development. Without development, human rights could not be truly universal, since universality must be predicated upon the most underprivileged in developing countries achieving empowerment. We cannot exclude the poorest of the poor from the universality of the rich. And also, frankly, it's an argument that we can turn around ourselves as people from countries such as India, which has a democracy and a human rights establishment and human rights NGOs and so on. And we are facing a government which may be looking askance at some of these things. Do some societies have the right to deny human beings the opportunity to fulfill their aspirations for growth and fulfillment legally and in freedom, while other societies organize themselves in such a way as to permit and encourage human beings freely to fulfill the same needs? On what basis can we accept a double standard that states that an Australian's need to develop his own potential is a right, while an Angolan's or an Albanian's, or for that matter an Adivasi's, is a luxury? I do want to make the point in saying this that universality does not presuppose uniformity. In asserting the universality of human rights, I do not suggest that our views of human rights have to be one size fits all, that they transcend all possible philosophical, cultural, or religious differences, or represent some sort of magical aggregation of the world's ethical and philosophical thought systems. Rather, it's enough that they do not fundamentally contradict the ideals and aspirations of any society and any human being. They reflect our common universal humanity from which no human being must be excluded. It is so easy, after all, for the same set of data, as all economists know, to be interpreted differently from two different perspectives, and the same sort of logic applies here. To conclude then, human rights, in my view, derives from the mere fact of being human. They're not the gift of a particular government or even of a constitution or a legal code. You have human rights because you're human. It's as simple as that. But the standards being proclaimed internationally can become reality only when applied by countries within their own legal systems. We have to work towards the indigenization of human rights, to assert human rights within each country's traditions and history. If different approaches are welcomed within the established framework, if, in other words, we can encourage eclecticism as part of the consensus and not as a threat to it, then such flexibility can guarantee universality, enrich the intellectual and philosophical debate, and so can complement rather than undermine the concept of universal human rights. Human rights, in other words, can keep the world safe for diversity. I hope I've given you all enough food for thought over the course of this lecture. Even if you may not necessarily subscribe to some of the arguments that I've laid out here, I hope you will continue to debate and discuss these themes with passion amongst yourselves and with your many peers from across the world, and that together, through your involvement, we may once again revive and champion a broader and more inclusive idea of human rights. In memory of Stan Swamy, I thank you all for your patience in listening to me. Thank you once again. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Dr. Tharoor. It's always a delight to hear you. I know there's a paucity of time, and we will be taking a very few short questions, maybe one or two. Could you please give the mic to the gentleman?
Dr. Tharoor, your sharing of thoughts has been brilliant, insightful, and outstanding.
Thank you so much. Do tell me who you are, sir. Sorry.
My name is Dolphy D'Souza.
Right.
But I want to ask you a question. Why we are not able to create a bloodied outcry? Why violations happen, particularly now in our country, specifically against the Muslims and then against the Christians so brutally? I always think that the idea of justice is when you become a victim. So what is your message to us based on your thoughts as to the challenges of creating that outcry?
Well, as you know, some of us have been trying to do so, and certainly I have not hesitated to be outspoken whenever injustices like this have occurred. I do want to make the point, I mean, when I speak about universality, that when the rights of any Indian is violated, we are all diminished. When a Muslim is hurt, let's never forget Pastor Niemöller's famous statement about what happened with the Nazis in Germany. He said, you know, first they came for the communists, and I did not object because I was not a communist. Then they came for the dissidents, and I did not object because I'm not a dissident. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not object because I was not a Jew. Finally, they came for me, and there was no one left to object for me. So I do say to all of you that if you find anyone's human rights being violated, in a sense, your own have been, because once violates rights can be violated, anyone's can be. But at the same time, it's also true that substantially, you know, first the Muslims, then the Christians, then the liberals, then the who else, that's not the way our society should slide down the path. I think we have to stand up from the very start and ensure that everyone's human rights are upheld. And that's the duty of all of us.
Dr. Tharoor, I am Sister Pauline. I had written to you once thanking you for your brilliant reflections. Now my question refers to women's rights. Sometimes I wonder whether women have any rights. The way things are, even in religious circles, not only outside. So it is, and I'm also, you know, involved with women's groups, not only intellectually, also down to earth. So I ask, in the name of culture, women have to be silent. And this is what we want you to do. And the religion brings in, adds to the misery of women. So what would you say to our church leaders, including our church leaders?
No. No, I, Sister Pauline, I understand where you're coming from. And I think, as I said in my remarks, culture does matter. It's very difficult to completely escape culture. So in the Christian church, except I think in one or two denominations like the Anglicans and so on, there is a differentiation between women of religion and men of religion as to who can be what. And so there are, if you like, certain inequalities built into it. Perhaps it'll evolve. I mean, lots of things in religion have evolved. And perhaps it'll change as well. But at the moment, that seems to be the practice. And we see similar issues in every faith. In Islam, of course, there is no notion of the equivalent of a nun. But it's even that women don't sit in the same place as men do during prayer and so on. So there are various kinds of rules. These have evolved, I suspect, from a particular cultural geography at a particular time when the religion was established and certain practices have continued. I mean, I was very struck to see a few priests at St. Paul's this evening wearing the kind of clothes they're wearing, because I had always assumed that everyone wore the sort of 16th century European clerical garb. And here we have Father Fraser looking like this, indeed you looking like that, and that's really... that's a change. In my childhood, I don't think I would have seen a priest in mufti, as it were. So, everything can change and evolve. And I certainly hope that culture does. And certainly that the restrictions on women, the inequality on women, is actually one of the most incomprehensible things for any thoughtful human being. Because actually, women are manifestly not just equal, they are superior to men. They can do things men can't do. No man can produce life the way a woman can, for one thing. And it's also true that particularly with technology, there is nothing a man can do in the 21st century, including going to war, that a woman can't do just as well, if not better. So where do men get this assumption of superiority from? Because women can do everything men do, plus one thing men can't do. And it seems to me that that already gives them a significant edge over the male half. On top of that, I mean, I've been noticing, and I don't know, I'm speaking in Mumbai, but having spent much of the last few years representing a constituency in Kerala, I've been invited to, God knows, over 50 convocations and their equivalent in various colleges, universities, and high schools, and research institutions. And one thing that I couldn't help noticing from the very start was the extent to which the prize winners and the rank list holders and the dean's list members and so on were dominated by women in every field. I did the convocation of the dental college, you know, 7 prize winners, all women. I did this at the medical university. There would have been sort of, you know, 20 or 30 in the top distinguished list, of which about, you know, 89%, 90% were women. And so it went. How is it that these brilliant females then end up somehow being stomped upon by society so that 20 years later, 25 years later, it's the men whom they defeated in class who are ahead of them and senior to them in the professions? There is something built into our society that's simply wrong. And I would assure you that as far as I'm concerned, I'm certainly prepared to speak out against injustice. I am proud that the organization that I established within the Congress Party, the All India Professionals Congress, has made a rule that we simply cannot have any chapter, each of our chapters, including our state levels, have a president, a vice president, a secretary. So we simply will not approve anything without at least one woman. There's more than one, fine. But there has to be at least one woman in these 3 positions. And that's something which I hope, in the unlikely event, as some people tell me, the unlikely event, that I succeed in my current quest. If I do that, I'm going to bring in the same rule in the Congress Party as well. We really have to make sure that women get a fair. Indeed, but then the Congress Party has supported the Women's Reservation Bill in Parliament. The 2 young people there.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Tharoor, for this. Yeah, so my question is, I want to talk about Gandhi. Like politics, Gandhi said that we have to have very respectful towards religion and mixed politics as well. And Ashish Nandi has also extensively written about that. So in present contemporary India, to counter the hard right-wing communalism, should we have a staunch secularist perspective, or should we also accommodate and discuss with these elements whom we as Congress people believe can come back to Congress if we have a discussion with them? So what do you propose, a staunch secularist stance or having a discussion and accommodating them?
So there are 2 aspects to your question. One is, of course, the principle. And on the principle, there is absolutely no doubt we are and stand for absolute secularism. But then there is the question of political tactics. How do you express your secularism in a way that doesn't drive away those who have abandoned you in the last couple of elections and gone to the other side? So there is this accusation that some of us in some elections and so on have kind of soft pedaled secularism and gone for what has been described as soft Hindutva. And I have argued that, you know, really there is no such thing. I am pretty proud of my Hinduism. I've written a book called Why I'm a Hindu that explains how I understand my Hinduism. But what I've said is that Hinduism is not and cannot be Hindutva, because the Hinduism that I grew up with, that I've understood and read and learned and been taught by the likes of Swami Vivekananda, is a Hinduism that believes in acceptance, not just tolerance, as Vivekananda famously said, but acceptance. Acceptance of difference is fundamental to Hinduism. The Hindu says, I believe I have the truth. You believe you have the truth. I will respect your truth. Please respect my truth. And to my mind, that's the best basis for coexistence in a multi-faith society like ours. Now, Hindutva doesn't say that. Hindutva says, we are better. They've reduced the majesty of the Upanishads and the great philosophical texts of Hinduism to sort of the team identity of the British football hooligan. You know, if you don't support my team, I'm going to bash you on the head. That, to my mind, is not Hinduism. They claim it is. They claim to do it in the name of Hindus like me. I don't accept that. So that's where the fundamental difference comes. So I will say that, you know, forget about, you know, Hindutva light or whatever, because if you try and sort of reduce Coke to Coke light, you end up with Coke Zero. That'll happen to us also if we do that. Yes, young man.
I have a question. You spoke about the rise of populism in Western democracies. And I would like to point out the fact that many people have noticed that the decline of working class organization, like for example, the Communist Party in Italy, recently there was an election where the post-fascist Fratelli d'Italia won, and it won with very strong support from the northern regions, which once supported the Communist Party. In a similar manner, in France, Le Pen's strongest supporters in the northern regions, who were once staunch communists. And also Boris Johnson's victory in 2019 was delivered by breaking into the staunchly working class red belt. So what do you think about the decline of working class organizations, general socialism, which leads to populism?
That's a superb question. How old are you, young man?
I'm 18.
Well done. Okay. And are you in your final year of school or?
Yeah, I've just passed our 12th.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm sure you'll go very far. Look, the reason is actually not that complicated to understand. For many in the working class, there was a period in which communism had appeal because it seemed to argue that they would empower the working class through organizing them, bringing their power forward, etc., into political office. And as you know, in most Western democracies, communist parties faded very quickly. The two countries where they lasted the longest were, in fact, the two you mentioned, France and Italy. But in both of them, by the 80s, an eclipse began. And certainly, that era of sort of what we call liberalization in India, globalization around the world and so on, which brought a lot of prosperity to people, resulted in what the communists would have called the embourgeoisement of the masses. And then the working class people no longer had a reason to vote for the communists because they felt that they had the means to live relatively comfortably and so on and so forth. But because they were still at the bottom of their societies, they were the most vulnerable to things like immigration, because immigration in many of these societies came from the working class. So you had poor laborers coming, accepting lower salaries. You had these particularly from Africa and the Middle East, people fleeing their countries, coming to these Western European countries, taking jobs, they became the principal competitors of the working class. So the resentment of outsiders, which is core to the rise of right-wing groups in Europe, was experienced directly, first of all, by the working class, because they were the ones who felt most vulnerable to the invasion of people. Now, when these outsiders come, you are threatened economically by their coming. But then you also start manifesting your dislike of other features, such as their color, such as their religious practice, such as the fact that they're different from you and so on. And that potent or lethal combination of right-wing elements, economic resistance and resentment, plus cultural resentment and dislike, and often religious bias as well, that becomes a heady brew that infects exactly the same people who once voted for the communists. That's why the same people have now become supporters of extreme right. As I said in an answer to somebody else earlier today, the most important thing to avoid is extremism, whether of the left or the right. They're very easy to slip from one to the next. What takes you a lot of effort to do, but what is really worth doing, is to stay focused in the center. That'll have to be the last question, ma'am. I'm going to have to wrap up.
As a voter in the last few years, I feel that my human rights are not respected. Because no matter which party I vote for, if my party is in a minority, the majority government, that the center somehow manages to topple it. We've seen it in Maharashtra, we've seen it all over. So how am I going to rely on the candidates whom I elect in every election and not be assured that they're going to defect? You know, and how are you going to protect my human rights?
Very good point. Now, there are two aspects to this. One is the fact that our system, which we borrowed from the British, is a winner-takes-all system. Now, in the British system, there are usually two, maximum three parties. There are no other serious candidates. In our case, very often there are many viable parties, depending, of course, on the nature of the race and where it takes place. But still, so quite often, an individual can win and become your MP or your MLA, or your councillor for that matter, without having a majority of the votes, because the majority is divided amongst others. We have the same picture nationally, where Mr. Modi has an overwhelming majority in Parliament on the basis of 37% of the national vote. And that means 63% did not want the policies that he represents, but he can truly point to his 303 seats in the Lok Sabha and say, I represent the popular will. And this is a genuine question to be asked, whether our system is fair in truly reflecting popular preference. Many other democracies have chosen other kinds of systems. Proportional representation is one option that some people find sensible. In other words, let's say everyone votes. And on that basis, you can do it either nationally, but because we're such a big nation, you might do it by state. Then in that particular state, let's say in one state, Mr. Modi has 37% and Congress has 19%. Somebody else has 5%, somebody else has 3%. That the seats are divided in that percentage. So Mr. Modi gets 37% of the seats and we get 19% of the seats and so on, up to a certain ceiling. Not a ceiling, actually, it'd be a floor. Let's say that anyone who wins, for argument's sake, 3% of the vote or less does not get a seat. But those above divide the seats amongst them. Now, that system is quite commonly practiced. Various countries have versions of that system. And in that system, you basically end up with permanent coalition governments, because very, very rare for someone to get 51%. There's another system called ranked choice preferential voting, which ironically in the Congress Party constitution is the system adopted for our elections. So had the third candidate who applied not been rejected because of some discrepancy in his form, our voters would have had to write numbers 1, 2, and 3 against our form in order to indicate. So then what would happen is the person with the lowest number of votes would have got knocked out, and then his preference, his voter's next preference. So if he's got number 1 from argument's sake 100 people, those 100 people's number 2 would then get a vote as if it was number 1, and that will make the difference between 1 and 2. So in the end, the effect of the system is that at the end of the day, somebody will win who actually has 51% or 50% plus 1. That's the second way of doing it. Now, these are possible approaches where you will not feel neglected. And the other thing, of course, for your last point, is of course we should outlaw defections.
Exactly.
Rajiv Gandhi thought he had done so, but our people have found creative ways around it.
Yeah.
And I think unless we succeed in passing a law which says essentially that anyone who changes parties is not eligible for re-election in the rest of that term.
Yeah. Yes.
But the problem is that that law would have to be passed by the present majority in Parliament, which are the biggest beneficiaries of defections.
Or so Congress. Or Congress if you come to power. Hopefully, I don't know.
Well,
do you think? Do you think for 2024 you have a chance?
I'm only contesting because of 2024. I feel that to be able to face 2024, to be able to take on the challenge of the BJP, I believe very honestly that a lot of people are unhappy with this government. 8.5 years, if I ask people in an audience, even this size, and say, how many of you feel that your lives have got better because of this government? How many hands will go up? One hand went. Oh, you're moving down. One hand has gone up. All right, so that's it. So if in a room of 550 people, one person thinks that their life has got better, you see what they... But the problem is often tended, and you can see why, right? There's been demonetization, there's been unemployment, there's been inflation, there's been spreading of hatred in our society. You can go list after list after list. So when you've got that going on, people are unhappy, but they look around and say, well, can we really sure there's a viable alternative? And so what I want to do is to try and revive the Congress Party in a way that it becomes that viable alternative. And so this election is taking place 1.25 years, basically just under 1.5 years before the 24 election. It's our last chance. As I say in one of my campaign slogans, abhi nahi to kabhi nahi. We really have to get this going in order to show that the party is capable of revival, of reinventing itself, of re-energizing itself, bringing in more young people, empowering the lower levels and so on, in order to be fighting fit to take on the BJP. That's the whole purpose of it. So I'm not fighting because, you know, I think I'm better than Mr. Kharge. I'm just thinking that my way of doing things might give us a better chance of going to the electorate in 24. That's my message. Thank you all very much.
Thank
it's been a great evening.